So how many iPhones have you personally bent, Jesse? Going around from
every day I gotta hear about somebody coming in their bent phone going, I heard this bends really easily.
And it broke in half.
Because apparently iPhone users don't understand that metal bends.
Really? just as a question of clarification, does this go for tonight's class as well?
Technically, that was a form of communication.
Thought I would trap you. All right. Today, what we're going to do is we're going to visit some more navigational elements. We talked about the tree view, which I struggled to explain last time and tried to find an example, but it's Windows 8. By the way, you heard that there is no such thing as Windows 9. They're going right from 8 to 10.
That's weird.
No, it isn't. I heard the best explanation for it ever. This is reasonable. And no, this isn't even
Windows,
a joke.
Are they calling Windows 9 the cell phones?
No, this isn't even a joke. Why do you think they're numbering it, instead of Windows 9, numbering it Windows 10?
So they can use the X.
I can't understand that. No, writing down.
No, that's a form of communication.
I guess no one has any clue. All right, too bad. No one in the class has any clue whatsoever. It does not have to do with Mac OS X. All right?
Is this
going to
be so bad that they just
want to save it? No, this is actually, and I don't have proof whether this is true or not, but this is reasonable. That there are many, I don't know what, applications, whatever, that have built into them code to check for Windows 95, Windows 98, that look something like this. If OS version equals Windows 9, and then a wild card after it. So if they did, they named a Windows 9, then some third-party applications would treat it internally like it was Windows 95 or Windows 98.
Oh wow, really?
Yeah, that was a theory. One of my tech friends posted that yesterday as a rumor why they're doing it. And again, I have no idea if that's true, but that's reasonable. And that doesn't, I mean, this isn't, you know, a Microsoft bashing thing, or this isn't a Apple, they wanted an OS X, you know, like Apple has an OS X, and it isn't some joke like Windows 8 was so bad and they had to jump up there. This makes sense, so I'm buying this until I hear a better explanation. All right, onward and upward. He was gonna take a Windows cheap shot and say it was Apple OS X. Then he's gonna pull out his iPhone and show that it doesn't bend and all that. All right. So let's download yesterday's or Tuesday's application, and let's make real quick a tree view. Is there a problem? Let's make real quick a tree view. And I'm going to make it the old-fashioned way. That is, I'm going to make it by hard-coding in the stuff. All right? So I'm going to make a tree view navigation that looks just like the regular navigation. I'm going to make a sitemap page, effectively. This, for example, would be LC's home page to talk about that. The site and all the page contained within it would be their website to clarify the difference. Popular guy today.
the example from last time. Let's make a sitemap page. Sitemap pages may also be a thing of the past. I don't see them as often as you used to, anyhow. But they have value. They have value if you have a particularly involved sort of navigation scheme and you want to present the whole scheme all at once. The tree view is a nice way to represent a sitemap. But you could also use it as your main navigation. I think it shows the degree to which stuff was compressed, maybe? I don't know. All right. Visual Studio. I'm going to go and I'm going to make my sitemap page. And the nice thing is to review, because the navigation is contained in the master page, I only have to make that change once. So I'm going to go and I'm going to make my sitemap page. I'm going to say new file, web form. I'm going to call it sitemap. And I'm going to say select master page because I want this to sort of inherit or extend the master page that we already have, to be a clone of. At least initially. I only have one choice, so the choice of which master page is pretty easy. Say hi to Alan. He vowed to be silent for the entire class today, so we're trying to trick him into speaking.
You guys want to see some of my yoga moves? No, I'm just kidding.
All right.
Yes, please.
So, we will go into the master page, and I will put the sitemap to it. And again, I could do this either through the UI or through the code view. I'm going to go into the code view, just for variety. And because all you're doing when you're using the UI and the graphical view, all you're doing is you're writing this code. You're just doing it through a graphical interface. And as I said before, you know, you can use either one, but it's good to at least have some familiarity with the code view, because the code view lets you see exactly what's going on. Sometimes a graphical user interface hides stuff from you. I mean, that's the whole point of a graphical interface, right? It hides stuff from you. It hides the details from you, so all you have to do is you know, the quote, easy part. So, I'm going to go and put the sitemap here. And I'm going to call the text sitemap. And sitemap. And I'll go in and to start, I'll simply put in an H1 that says, this is our sitemap. All right, so I'll go and run this. I think I've mentioned this before. You probably have noticed that whatever page you're working on, that's a page that is going to open up in the browser, unless you go and you set the start page, which is something I usually do, because I usually want it to start, and I'm not doing this just for a reaction. I usually want it to start at the home page, all right? So I will go and I'll make that the the start page. So every time it comes up, it comes to this page. All right. But as you can see, because I did this on the master page, adding that link gets put on every page. All right. So I'm going to go and set the default page as the start page so I can get that effect. So I'll right mouse on it and say set as start page. Now it doesn't matter what I am looking at. I'm on the sitemap page here. If I fire this up, it's going to open up the default page. All right. So now let's go and build the sitemap. And initially, we are going to build the sitemap based on just hard-coded values like we did the menu. So I'm going to go and I'm going to use, for navigation, I'm going to use a tree view. Now, if you notice, a tree view, you know, conceptually is the same as a menu. Right? A tree view has items, it has levels, it has nesting of items within levels. The difference being is that a tree view, you can leave things open, or you can leave things expanded, let's put it that way, and it'll stay expanded regardless of what else you do. So if you click on an item on a tree view, it stays expanded. So if you move your mouse around, you still have that list. Whereas in a menu, when you mouse over, when you mouse out, it goes away. So I'll go in and I will create hard-coded edit nodes. I'll go in and add the home page. Navigate URL. Default.aspx. I'll add the Hello Kitty page.
Hello Kitty.
I can just imagine, like, if there's some little kid somewhere that's, like, looking for Hello Kitty videos and, like, comes across this and then, like, is so enthralled by my lectures that they end up being like a famous technology expert or something, like a young Bill Gates or, you know.
Are you going to hashtag this video Hello Kitty?
I should.
You should.
Okay. It's probably less likely that the Keith Richards fan would read this and be inspired.
I don't. Creepy looking.
Yeah, well.
And no one cares anymore. Well, spoiler, no one cares anymore.
And let's see, what else did I have on here? I had a vote and a sitemap, and then I had some pages under Hello Kitty. So, vote. This is roughly, I mean, the screen might look a teensy bit different. I think they call them items in a menu, or they call this nodes in a tree view. But other than that, it's the same thing. You're specifying the name and value, and you're specifying the URL that corresponds to it. And likewise, we can go and we can add things on the same level, or we can add children to nodes. So this one would be sitemap. Then we had a few things underneath Hello Kitty. So for that, I'm not going to click add a root node. I'm going to say add a child node. So we had Hello Kitty store, gallery, and bio. I didn't want to do that. All right. And I didn't do that on purpose, but it's a good thing to show. I made that underneath Hello Kitty store. I really want it on the same level. So I can use this to push it over a level. So now, boom, it's on the same level as Hello Kitty store. or I can demote it. All right. It sounds goofy, but that's the terminology they use. You can promote or demote. So you can put it on a lower level, or you can put it up on a higher level. So, Hello Kitty Gallery. And then finally, and I can put that up a level, up a level, up a level, and then over to get it in the position where I really wanted it. So, what was the last one? Bio. Alright, so now we have our sitemap in the form of a tree view. Now I can show the lines that sort of show the directory structure, or the logical structure. This isn't really a directory structure. I also have a lot of other attributes I can set here for this. I can set, for example, how much I indent the nodes. Whether to show the lines or not. Well, I was looking for one in particular. Expand depth. How far should it initially be expanded? All right. And right now it's shown as fully expanded. In other words, it's going to show the whole tree. So regardless of how many levels I had, it would initialize to showing the whole tree. I could also say expand 0 levels. And again, with the idea that, remember, in software development, 0 means the first level, so the ground level. All right. So now I can run this. And when we go to our sitemap, we have a tree view that we can go and we can expand it. And again, based on my settings, I can go and use that as a navigation to get to my favorite page. Now, in this case, we only have like the 2 levels, and we only have 2 levels for one of the nodes. But again, you can see, notice as I move the mouse around, when I expand a node, it stays expanded. Alright, so by clicking on the node, by clicking on the plus sign, I expand it, and it's going to stay expanded until I click the minus sign. And when I click the minus sign, it's going to stay collapsed until I go and click the plus sign again. Questions about this? Why are the links the color that they are? Pardon me? Right. Right. Exactly. In other words, if I look at my CSS, I probably don't see anything relating to the color of the links. And I'll tell you, this is one of the biggest oversights I see in student work. All right, is they create this really nice color scheme, but they never address the colors of the link. And therefore, you end up with combinations that look hideous. All right, this actually isn't too bad. I mean, blue, the blue stands out against the pink. The magenta sort of is visible. So this actually isn't bad. But you should take care to make sure that your link color goes with the rest of the stuff. And as was mentioned, some of the links are blue, some of the links are magenta, because that's a default browser setting for links and for visited links. Alright. This should be just a review of CISS 216, but we can go in and we can make the links have whatever color they want, and we can do a color for the link, we can do a color for the hover, we can do a cover for visited, and we can do it for active. And I don't remember what active means. No, that's hover. I think active is when you have focus on it through the keyboard. So like, there, notice that. Yeah, notice that there's like a dotted line around Hello Kitty. I think that's what active is.
I assume this could be all adjusted in CSS.
And this would all be adjusted in CSS. And let's do that again. Not that that's specific to this class, but it's good to remember our basic design principles, because we're making web pages, right? We should make finished, polished looking web pages. So I'm going to go in and I'm going to say A, and I'll make the color black.
You can even take the other lines away, which some people do. That looks terrible.
It can be obvious. I mean, you can make them look like buttons, and you can put a different background on them. But yeah, you better be sure that you know what you're doing if you do something like that. So I can say A. There's an order you're supposed to do these in. We'll do hover, and I'll make the color of it. We'll try white. I don't know if that's going to look good or not, but we'll see. And finally, A visited. Keep in mind, I don't have to just change the color. I could make it bold. In fact, let's do that.
Can't you change the font too?
Yeah, we could change the font too, or the font size. In fact, let's do this. Font. Wait. Yeah, that's the one I want. Well, it's IntelliSense for this is great. I wish.
It really is.
I wish we'd use this in CISS 216. Actually, no, I don't.
So do I.
No, I'm being sarcastic.
Well,
here.
You really have to know how to do it too.
Yeah, you do. You have to know. It's like the difference between using a calculator in a third grade math class versus using it in a college calculus class. You know.
I guarantee if you were really a programmer really working on this, if you only use that design view, you're going to get burned sooner or later.
Oh, absolutely. Absolutely. So I'm going to go and I'm going to say font size 1.2m, which is going to make it slightly bigger. So I'm going to make it bold and slightly bigger. And hover, I'm going to make it white. Oh, I already have hover. Hover, we'll do visited. And color will do a shade of gray. All right.
Got 50 Shades of Gray, is it?
Actually, that I never understood the title of that book, because there's actually 256 shades of gray if you include white and black. If you don't include white and black, there's 254. So that book is totally misnamed. All right. There I notice. Makes it bigger. Once I click on it, then it kind of like gives it like a "Hey, you've already been there" look, and all that. So I'm not sure I made the best choices here. All right, but
you probably wouldn't do it like that on your navigation, you know. But in other links, you know, because you're going to keep
going to them. Right, and that's a good point. Here's the navigation in the sitemap. What if I wanted a different scheme for the sitemap than I wanted for the nav? How could I get that to work?
Well,
Pardon me?
You have to find the name on the sitemap, what you want.
No. What I could, go ahead.
Oh, you precede it with like the name of the div.
I could, yeah, and again, this being that we're doing this in HTML5, we actually don't have to do like the idea of the div. We can simply say that I want stuff in the nav section. Links in the nav section to be treated one way. So I could go in here and I could make this just apply to links in the navigation section. So I don't need the ID, I don't need a class. I can still do that, but...
a point for why they made names for specific divs.
Like yeah, and exactly. This is exactly why they did it. To make it so that, you know, it's not just that there is a bunch of undifferentiated sections on your page. There are sections on the page that fulfill a certain role. So let's tag them that way. And that makes your page more semantic. In other words, you can look at the structure of the page and understand. Or a bot can look at it. A search engine can look at it.
Or another programmer.
Or another programmer. Or creating CSS style. So now if we look at this, we see that the links in the nav section have that behavior, but the links in the sitemap don't. All right, they're back to the default. Always remember that the way your page looks depends on two things. It depends on the CSS code that you have coded, and it depends on the defaults of the language in the browser. So, links are blue and underlined. Why? Well, that's the default of the browser. Unless you change them, then your CSS is taking control. All right? And you can again, like we did in this case, you can be very specific about how you go in and you do this. All right. Now, let's look to see how good a job I did keeping this consistent. Pretty good, but I switched those. All right. The question was is how we could style that. Let's go back and look at the style sheet. There was a question last time that said how I could style it to be a different color. And what I did is I ran this, and I looked at the HTML that was created. And I saw that those secondary links were actually LIs within an LI. In other words, there's a listed item. So therefore, I put a style rule that says, in the navigation section, if you have an LI within another LI, make the background red. Now, red's a pretty ugly color for that, so I probably would make the background maybe pink, maybe a lighter shade of pink. We can go to our color chart.
So, like, if you're working with blue, you can try light blue. So just start typing light.
Oh, cool. I'll tell you, this IntelliSense is gonna ruin the programming world. She's shocked about something. And you can
save a bunch of money by switching. Guys.
And I say, and you can bet your bottom dollar, I'm not going to find out what she's shocked about. All right, let's go and run this. And now we'll have it looking a little more reasonable. Or not. I don't know. It's not a particularly good color, but you get the idea. The initial problem that we were trying to solve is without this code in here, because we did not specify a background color, we had some overlap. And you couldn't read the sub-navigation.
Well, because you changed it already.
Yeah, we can now. I actually added these two things in for that. But before I made those changes, yeah, transparent, you had the issue of it showing through. So one of the ways to fix it would be to go in and add a background color on those LIs so it won't be transparent. There was much discussion over whether that was the best solution or make it so that it did not overlap text. I took the stance of it's the whole purpose of having drop-downs is to save the real estate on the page, to save the space on the page. So therefore, you don't want to leave a gap just so that that will not appear. So that's why I put a background color on it. All right. Now, if you notice, you notice something. You notice, first of all, folks aren't paying attention today because you should have been screaming. All right? Why should you have been screaming?
We saw Keith Richards' face.
Okay, besides seeing, we didn't see Keith Richards' face today. I know, we probably brought up that mental image of him. But
did you see his sub-pages?
Well, no, because I repeated myself. I did the exact same thing in the sitemap as I did in the menu. Right? I duplicated effort. Now, what's wrong with that? Well, the very same issue is wrong with that as duplicating any code. Number one, I could make a mistake and make it inconsistent. Not that I made the worst mistake, but I did. And this is completely inadvertently. I made the mistake and these two are inconsistent. The order of this, store bio gallery, and the sitemap, it goes store gallery bio. All right? Not a huge difference, but the whole point of a navigation is consistency. When you start like screwing up things and screwing up the consistency of it, you know, that's where you get into problems and confusion and so on. The other thing is if I would have to go and change something. Let's say, for example, I was going to create a Keith Richards gallery. Now you should be screaming for a different reason. All right, I'll go and do a new file, web form, KR gallery, select master page, and I'll put in just an H1 that says Keith Richards gallery. Mercifully, I will not actually put any images on there. Yeah. Well, this is something you can, if you really want to, you can complete this on your own. But now I have a new page, right? And I got to add it. Where do I have to add it? I have to add it in two places. I have to add it on the master page for under Keith. And notice how this is structured, because the Keith Richards one is going to be underneath, because I want the gallery to be underneath the Keith Richards section, I am going to put it as part of that menu item. So within the Keith Richards menu item, I have a second menu item for his gallery. So I go and run this, and there we have that. There we have that. I go to the sitemap. Oops, it's not there. Right? Whole point of the issue with duplication is that if you make a change, you have to go and change it twice. All right? We've already seen that there's substantial gain here that we get from creating a master page, right? Because I didn't have to go in and add that link to all of the, what do I have by now? 8, 10 pages. I just added it to the master page. But I still, because I have a sitemap with a separate sitemap, I have to go, tree view, I have to go in and add it here in order for this to be complete. So, same thing here. I'm going to go and put between the tree node. I'm going to put, notice how this, because it's underneath the Keith Richards section, is part of the Keith Richards tree node. It's nested. It shows containment or structure, however you want to put it. And now we should be back in sync, or not. I saw the little green squiggly lines. So I'm thinking I did something wrong. Oh, maybe not.
You ended tree node twice.
I should end tree node twice because... Let's go and look at that. Microsoft. That's not an error. There's white space there. That's not. I didn't have text there. I had white space there. Ooh. All right. At any rate.
So it was counting that as space.
So it's counting that as that I had text. Yeah. So. What was the question about the appearance of this?
Why is there
that? I'm sure you can.
I'm sure there's a property for that.
Yeah. I don't have a good answer why it looks that way. I'm not sure.
I would assume there would be another site map under that.
Repeat.
That's B there.
Yeah, exactly. And that could be, I could have a problem.
Is that there by default, then, I think?
It must be, yeah.
That's weird.
Yeah, it is. Looks right, but I don't know.
Is it a property on the tree node?
It's a property on the tree node to, or is a property on the tree to show a line or not?
To show a line or not.
Right. Okay. So, we've seen the problem, and the problem is that we duplicated our work. This is going to lead to an important concept that is going to be relevant here, but it also is going to be relevant the rest of the class. And that is the notion of data binding, all right? That is, instead of hard coding in a set of values for a menu view, for a tree view, we are instead going to get the data to fill in the details of the menu and the tree view from someplace else. It's not going to be hard coded in there. We're going to have a data source. And when we get into it, you know, next week probably, we're going to be pulling stuff from the database. And in that way, we're going to ensure consistency. So, for example, we have a drop-down of a list of majors, let's say, at Lorraine Community College. And there might be, you know, 100-some things that you can major in. All right? We come across and we create a new major. We create a major for mobile software development. There could be a whole bunch of places where there's a list of majors on LC's site. Do we want to have to go to all dozen places and add mobile software development? No. We want to put that in the database as an entry, and then have all those places that need to show a list of majors get their data from the database. And bind the visual control, could be any number of visual controls. Could be a table of majors. It could be a drop-down that shows majors. It could be a navigation that shows majors and links to the pages about them. We would bind every reference to majors to the data from that database table. Well, we're not quite at the point of doing database tables yet, all right? But we are going to bind it to a sitemap file, all right? What is a sitemap file? A sitemap file is an XML file that defines the structure of our website, all right? It defines pretty much like we just created the root nodes, the nodes underneath it, the children underneath it, and if there's children underneath that, and so on. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to go and I'm going to change what I have a little bit by first of all defining a sitemap file, sitemap XML file, and we'll look at how that's done and we'll look at what that's structured like and so on. And then we'll go back in and we'll change our menu view, or our menu, and our tree view to use the sitemap data instead of having the data hard-coded. So how do I make a sitemap? File, new, file. I'll scroll down a bit. Sitemap. I click add. And I get a head start on creating it. It doesn't know, by it I mean the sitemap editor, or however you want to put it, it doesn't know what the structure of your site is. We have to define it. And we have to define it to show all the different pages on our site and the structure of how they're nested. Now, here's one thing about a sitemap. Notice if I do that, I get an error. The little blue underline says the element sitemap in namespace has an invalid child element, sitemap node, blah, 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 blah. Let's understand what that's doing there. All right. First of all, have we seen blue squiggly lines before?
Yes.
When have we seen blue squiggly lines before?
Just a second ago
when we had white space. In other words, and you're right, I forgot about that actually. Right. You see blue squiggly lines when... Well, here we see a green squiggly line. But you see the squiggly lines when we have broken the rule of HTML. So, for example, let's go and let's put a div tag after the body. Okay, again, we see a green squiggly line, not a blue squiggly line. What that's telling us is that we broke the rule, we broke a markup rule. What's a markup rule? A markup rule is what tags you can have where. Alright? And if you, or a markup rule is that the tags have to be nested properly. Or a markup rule is that a starting tag needs an ending tag. There's a whole bunch of markup rules. And we've, in the past, in CISS 2.16, used the W3 C.org validator to see if you've broken any of the markup rules. Here, the editor tells you if you've broken any markup rules. The problem with the markup rule is browsers are forgiving. All right, browsers are forgiving. Browsers are meant to be forward compatible. What does forward compatible mean? We've heard of backwards compatible. What does forward compatible mean? It's the opposite of backward compatible. Okay, what backward compatible would mean that if a new browser comes out, it can still display old versions of HTML. So, let's say today a brand new version of Google Chrome comes out, and it has all the best HTML5 features and so on. It won't break if it sees an HTML4 document. All right, that's what backwards compatible means. Or Microsoft Word. Microsoft Office 2013 comes out, and there's a new format for storing Word files. But you could still open a Word file that was created in Office 98, let's say, or whatever. That's what you mean by backwards compatible. All right? Forward compatible means that... It should work on some level for stuff that comes out after the browser was created. So, and this is a longer discussion than I wanted to, but it's pretty interesting because it shows that the makers of browsers and HTML are pretty clever, right? So, for example, if I have an old version of Internet Explorer, I have Internet Explorer 6, all right, and I open up an HTML5 page. Do I get an error? Does it blow up? No, it doesn't blow up. Doesn't give you a compile error like it would, you know, like if you're writing in C# or something like that. Does it display correctly?
Maybe
not. It depends. It depends on specifically which tags were used. But at least it doesn't blow up. So there's a chance that at least it will be usable even with an ancient browser. That's what forward compatibility means. All right. So that's why it doesn't give you a compile error. It's like, okay, we're going to put something out there. If the browser doesn't understand it, fine. Let the browser take a shot at understanding it. And then, if it does... Great. If it doesn't, oh well. Maybe what it will come up with will be, at the very least, will be workable. All right. Now, and that's why XML is so, that's why HTML is so forgiving, right? I can put a nonsense tag that I just made up in my HTML, and it's not going to blow up the page. It's not going to do anything, right? The browser simply ignores tags that it doesn't understand, all right? Which is kind of a cool strategy to ensure forward compatibility. You don't understand a tag? Well, I just won't do anything with it. All right? Now, XML is a little different because with XML there are very rigid rules for what needs to be there, and if stuff isn't there that should be or is there that shouldn't be, then the programs that process XML files aren't going to work right. They're not as forgiving as browsers would be. So, XML files such as the sitemap have some rules. All right. Oh, that's not what I was looking at. One of the rules says that a sitemap XML file, and again, this is a bunch of tags, just like an HTML document is a bunch of tags, but one of the rules says that within a sitemap, there can only be one root sitemap node. So therefore, this is okay because there's only one sitemap node within the sitemap, this is not okay because there's two sitemap nodes there.
Can you add a sitemap to that and put that sitemap node?
Well, you can nest it because that's what they're doing here. Notice there are multiple sitemap nodes, but they're all contained within the quote root.
I mean, if you copied that whole sitemap tag to sitemap tag and then duplicated it on that page.
No. No, and again, the same rule applies is that there is only one root sitemap tag.
Follows Highlander rules. Then.
Follows what?
Highlander rules. There can only be one.
I don't know what that means. So.
You didn't watch Highlander? That's like the greatest,
I don't want to talk about it. I don't want to talk about it on camera.
Alan's agreeing with me. That's how badly he wants to speak right now. Highlander rules are good.
Okay, so the rules are, and these are strict rules because XML is stricter than HTML. XML has to beat the rules, otherwise you got trouble. XHTML says, well, you know, follow the rules, and if you don't, well, I'll give it a shot anyhow. So the XML rule says one sitemap node in an XML file. One sitemap node off of that, and then as many sitemap nodes underneath there as I want.
So we're actually writing an XML file.
We're creating an XML file, exactly. Okay. So I'll go here and I can put the root. Is there a question? Or I can put the root in here. So default.aspx title home page description home. Underneath that, there is Hello Kitty.ispx. I'm going to do all the first level stuff first,
can
then we'll
do
it.
Tilde forward slash in here?
Probably not, but I could put it in. Probably is a good practice.
And that just represents the file.
That represents that this is in this application's root folder. Issues worked out. Set of children.
Yeah, what I really meant was you're writing the sitemap, not the sitemap, the what's on the top of the
right.
Yeah, the navigation.
All right. Now I need to put in the stuff that goes underneath Hello Kitty and the stuff that goes underneath Keith Richards. How am I going to do that? Again, it's the same concept as HTML. How do you show what belongs to a paragraph? How do you show what belongs to a list? How do you show what belongs to the head section, whatever? It's by containment. It's by nesting. So, right. So, I'm going to go and I'm going to remove this, this being just a shorthand, just like in HTML, for a start and end tag rolled into one. So I'm going to get rid of that. And I'm going to code explicitly the end site map node. And then I'm going to put in the sitemap node for the three Hello Kitty pages.
You know, you say you hate IntelliSense, but you sure as hell copy and paste the whole bunch.
I'm sorry, if you're going to mumble, I can't hear what you're saying, and I'm not going to respond to it.
Copy and pasting isn't using IntelliSense.
You know, when calculators came out, they banned those, too. When copy and
pasting... I'm sorry, did someone say something? Actually, when calculators came out, and I was around for it, I had a physics teacher that taught that we still had to use slide rules. All right? And his rationale was this. When you use a calculator, you trust the result without thinking about it. When you use a slide rule, you have to think about, like, the order of magnitude. So on a slide rule, you'll get 2.7. You have to be aware enough of the numbers that you're dealing with to know, is that 270? Is that 2.7 million? Is that 0.27? And it gives you a number sense. Whereas if you punch things in a calculator and it tells you that that can of water over there weighs 6 tons, you're going to put down on your lab report, can of water weighs 6 tons, you know, without thinking about it. So there was some value to that, I will say. So, I'm almost done.
What's the description for?
That's a good question. It doesn't appear visually. We'll have to look to see if it makes it to the HTML or if it's just like a notational thing.
I didn't know if it, like, when you hovered over it, it displayed.
That's a good question. I honestly don't know. It's possible. We'll have to look to see if this makes it to the HTML. Okay, so now I'm going to have this sitemap file, but it's not tied to anything. It's just sort of floating out in space. What I have to do now is I have to bind it to my visual control. So this is a theme that will be repeated as we get in the databases. You have a source of the data, and that source of the data gets bound to some visual control. And again, should be no secret that this is a continuation of a theme, right? Separating stuff, all right? The objects and classes that do the menu kind of work are one thing. The data that's going to fill in that menu is another thing. So we're going to keep them separate so we can reuse the one, and we can plug things in, or we can dynamically change it, or whatever. So now, what I'm going to do is I'm going to go and I'm going to make the menu and the sitemap both use this, the menu and the sitemap page both use this sitemap file. So, I'll go to my master page.
Is there a way to check that now that you have it written that you didn't, like,
Yeah, no blue lines.
Just no blue lines.
Right.
There's no way to like view it so that you can see it.
Well, we're going to view it when we create the menu control right. And when we create the tree view. Mm-hmm. All right. So I'll go here and I'll click on that and I will say choose data source. Making a new data source. And where is it going to come from? Is the data going to come from a sitemap file, or is it going to come from some other XML file? Well, it's going to come from my sitemap. Okay. So now, our menu comes from the sitemap file. Why does it only show the home page and everything else it's hovering? Well, because... Well, no. Because... I probably said somewhere here only show one level. Let's show two levels instead. And now we have the two levels worth. So if I go and look at this now in the source view, it still has those items that I created, but they're not going to do me any good. I can go and get rid of those items.
Because that's on its own page.
Because it's in its own file. Right. And if I run this, then I get... this. I'm back to how it looked before, but I can go and do the same thing for the sitemap.
It looked like it took a little longer to render, too. Like it was still in the data.
Did you have a stopwatch out? Or
yeah.
I didn't. I swear I could not tell any difference between that.
You gotta watch these.
I guess. Anyone out there, any Keith Richards or Hello Kitty fans, if you want to watch this and test the amount of time that it took, I'll be glad to hear your results. I find it almost impossible to believe that there was a perceptible difference.
Okay.
Yeah, I just don't see it. Just don't see it. We're not talking about tons of data here. All right, let's go to our sitemap page and let's do effectively the same thing about the sitemap. Or the same thing we did with the menu. So I'm going to go and I'm going to get rid of all the nodes for this guy, all the stuff that I hard-coded, and I'm going to go in here and I'm going to choose the data source. From the sitemap file. Now I just have to change it in one place. And again, it's only showing the one level, but I can change that if I want to in the properties. To one, or however many I want. And I'm back in business. Now, last but not least, breadcrumbs. All right, what are breadcrumbs? Breadcrumbs show you the path of how you got there, how you got to a particular page. So it shows right up in the, you can show, put on the top of the page, sort of how you got there. So in other words, to get to the Hello Kitty store page, I went from home to Hello Kitty to Hello Kitty store, and so on. Shows me that structure. This is something I want to appear on every page, so I'm going to put it in the master page. And they don't call it breadcrumbs. They call it sitemap path. So I'm going to put their sitemap path. And now when I run this, I will get sort of my path as I click through. I go to the Hello Kitty page, it shows me home, Hello Kitty. Go to Hello Kitty gallery, home, Hello Kitty gallery. Alright, it does that automatically.
Will it'll change if you go to a lateral one, to a different level, like if you went to Keith Richards level, it would change from Hello Kitty?
Yeah.
Okay. So it knows
right.
Not to just keep adding them as you go.
Exactly. Exactly. It's not showing you your history. It's showing you where your current page fits in the overall structure of the site, as defined in your sitemap file. All right. So now if I wanted to go and add a page, if I wanted a page for the Keith Richards bio, might actually need two pages for that one. I can go in and then, to add it to all the navigations, I simply need to go in the sitemap file and put it where it belongs. And in this case, it belongs in the Keith Richards section. So I can copy this node. Put that there. There and there. And when I run it, it's going to be on the menu, it's going to be on the sitemap, and it's going to have the proper breadcrumbs.
So how do you style that, like if you want to take it, so you have home sitemap, and then you want to make it, make the sitemap part, the page you're actually on, look like different color, because you're on it. You know what I mean? Because usually it looks different on a page.
What do I want to make look different? No, I'm really asking a question. What is it about this? I'm on the sitemap page. What do I want to look different?
On your breadcrumbs there.
Well,
that's what I was talking about.
The way breadcrumbs work, you're always on the last page of the stream.
Okay.
So you really don't need to differentiate that.
Okay.
All right. So our menu gets changed. Our breadcrumbs gets changed. And we're consistent so that any change I make is reflected in both places. So these are nifty little navigational things that you can do to improve the navigation of your site. You know, what makes for good navigation? You know, good navigation lets someone see where they are, the breadcrumbs sort of do that, where they've been, the breadcrumbs show you that. In addition, having a different color for visited links shows you that. And finally, where else you can go, and the menu selections do that. The other thing I would say about good navigation is something that isn't technical, but is more of a design thing. And that is figuring out how to categorize and how to structure your pages to begin with. So, for example, in this case, I have Hello Kitty and Keith Richards on the top, and underneath them I have Bio, Store, and Gallery. I could have just as well had Home, Biographies, and underneath that have Hello Kitty and Keith Richards. Store, underneath that, have Hello Kitty and Keith Richards. And finally, Gallery, and underneath that, I'd have Hello Kitty and Keith Richards. You have to put yourself in the shoes of people visiting your site. But what sort of organization would make more sense to them? Keeping in mind that you're not just getting one kind of user visiting your site. You have what we called in CISS 2.16 as different personas, different groups of people with different goals that are visiting your site. And as such, keep that in mind as you're designing and deciding what sort of navigation that you're going to have. Questions? In a nutshell, you're supposed to do this for whatever lab it is, lab 5. I don't remember when it's due, but you make a multi-page site that has navigation, sitemap, and breadcrumbs. You don't have to have tons of content, but you have to do more than I did here. You know, I get a lot of students saying, you know, hey, you know, can I put Greek text on it? Or just show me the shell or template of it. It needs to look like a finished page. You don't have to have tons of content, but you need to have some content. All right? And it doesn't, you know, and you do need to style it to look semi like a completed page as opposed to just having no styling whatsoever. Questions? Alan, how would you like me to finish class today? You don't want me to finish class today.
Okay.
In that case, we will not finish class today. We will, however, continue class until further notice.
In the lab.
And it will be, for the next hour, it will be in the lab. But after that, it will be wherever you find yourself. All right. See you there.
I often find myself lost.
I have to say, I didn't think you could do it.
Yeah,
he's still in character. This is like